about the mountains and the lakes and the deserts and the sunflowers and all the animals, although I want to make the point that that is part of it. But I believe he was talking about all of creation, especially about people. Creative and crafty humanity. That is who God seems to love the most out of all of creation. This complex God who makes the deserts bloom and the birds sing loves all of his creation, and he especially loves us. That is amazing. God loves the world, us, sinful and messed up humanity at times, the whosoevers of this world. Many years ago, the governor of one of the states was frustrated with the turmoil that existed in the state prison system. And he was asked in an interview what his administration planned to do about the problem. He replied, "We are never going to have better prisons until we get a better class of prisoners." I want to tell you what party this is from. I am not sure what the governor meant by that. But he has certainly hit upon our problem. This world sometimes could use a better class of humanity. The truth was illustrated to me from a book by Dr. Shirley Strom entitled Almost Human. And it was actually the full title, Almost Human, A Journey into the World of Baboons. Well, she was an anthropologist who studied one population of baboons in Kenya for 38 years. And in her book, she describes the wonderful world of modern, what she calls baboonery. He apes and she apes, which she saw living in harmony and all that good stuff. In this book, she suggests that there are many features that we humans could look into with the baboons that could be a solution, perhaps, to some of our own cultural problems. And that's what's in the book, if you want to read it. The relationships are so well-rounded and healthy, she said, that the baboon model provides a source of hope and optimism for all of us. One writer suggested that if this is true, when someone calls you, "You big ape," that might be a compliment instead of a put-down. When you consider some of humanity's pitiful records on Earth, so bad that we're told to go back to the baboons for hope, it's remarkable sometimes that this God of ours so loved the world. That's the first great truth that is very essential in our faith. But there's more. God so loved the world that he gave his only son. That is amazing. In fact, it's almost beyond comprehension. The Smithsonian once wrote an article on Bill and Betty Friedman, who were called some of the greatest makers and breakers of secret codes in history. There were some films on this, you might have seen one of them. You name it, they could crack the code. When an American military code needed a final test of its secrecy, the U.S. government would call on Friedman's. Well, Bill and Betty had busted it in 3 hours. And the code that they had busted said, "This cipher is absolutely indecipherable." But the Friedman showed that it wasn't. Their feats are legendary among those who know about this sort of thing. And just prior to World War II, they cracked a very dangerous Japanese code. And wartime enemies were their targets. Drug rings were uncovered, and German war messages were explained. They were very brilliant and able to do what very few could do. But even with their brilliant mind, they had to be compulsive workers, and they often worked till 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning to break down each code. They would even agree that unlocking mysteries is very hard work. To many of us, unlocking the mysteries of God and his will is in similar ways that of Friedman's effort of cracking the mysteries and the codes. Truth appears to us in deep and mysterious ways. The very simplicity of the gospel is often an obstacle to this mystery and to our faith. God loves us so much, he's willing to give us the ultimate gift, the gift of his Son. Simple, yet, but also very mysterious, and yes, very profound. It is our understanding of the life and death and resurrection of Jesus Christ that God so loved the world, that he loved the world so much that he gave his only Son. But there's still more to that mystery. God loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish, but will have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world, the whosoever's of the world, might be saved through him. Now, we're a very diverse congregation. If you've been here for a while, you've noticed that. And I kind of like that about our congregation, because it is very mysterious, this gospel that we are learning to live. And so, therefore, none of us have all the answers. As such, we look at Scripture and faith differently at times. There are some of us here that believe that people must respond to faith in this life to the saving grace of Jesus Christ. Others believe that there's other paths to God that are also acceptable. Even some evangelicals, such as Rob Bell in his book, Love Wins, believes that all will eventually respond positively to the grace of God, either now or sometime between death and the next life, with love winning and God redeeming all of creation, that the world indeed will be saved. However, no matter what your view is in this diversity that exists in our congregation, please do not miss one of the main points of this passage. God's purpose with the world that he loves is not to condemn it. No matter what you hear out there, this passage makes it clear that God is not here to condemn it, but he's here to save it. Whosoever is a crucial concept here. It makes no difference what our lives have been like before. We may feel like we've been the biggest loser, or the biggest failure, or the biggest sinner that ever lived. It makes no difference because the mystery is clear. The grace of the gospel is for whosoever. It makes no difference what race you are. It makes no difference what social status you're in. It makes no difference what your sexual orientation is. It makes no difference whether you're a Baptist, a Covenant, a Lutheran, a Catholic, or whatever. God is here to accept whosoever. I read a story a while back that I might have used before, but I think it really speaks to our message this morning. It's about a person whose name was Paul. He talked about a time in his childhood, a long time ago, when phones first were something in the homes. And he was confronted with a mystery of his own. His parents became the proud owners of one of the first telephones in their neighborhood. It was one of those wooden boxes, if you've seen one of those old phones, that was attached to the wall with the receiver hanging on the side of the box, with the mouthpiece and the receiver that was connected to the front. Paul would listen in amazement as he watched the mystery of his parents being able to speak into that box and talk to someone. He said the mystery to him was that someone amazing must live in that telephone. He got brave to use the phone when his parents were not watching. And he discovered that the name of this mysterious person that they talked to was called Information Please. He said that there was nothing that Information Please did not know. He said that one day when he was home alone, he accidentally hit his finger with a hammer. He said the pain was so severe that he didn't know what to do. So he called Information Please, hoping she could help. When Information Please came on the phone, she explained the situation. He explained the situation, and he was crying and weeping as he was on the phone. And the person, Information Please, said, "Isn't your mother home?" And Paul said, "No, nobody's home." "Are you bleeding?" she asked. "No," cried Paul. "I hit my finger with a hammer and it hurts real bad." "Can you open the icebox?" she asked. "Yes," cried Paul. "Then get some ice and put it on your finger." Paul did that and helped a lot. After that, Paul said that he would call information, please, for everything. She helped him with his geography and with his math. She taught him how to spell words and what to feed his pet chipmunk. And when Paul's pet canary died, she listened to his grief tenderly. And then she said to him, "Paul, always remember there are other worlds to sing in. Always remember there are other worlds to sing in." Somehow, that helped Paul to feel better. When Paul was 9 years old, his family moved away and they moved to Boston. And as years passed, he missed information, please, very much. Some years later, when he was on his way out west to go to college, his plane landed in Seattle, his old home. And he dialed the hometown operator and he said, "Information, please." To his surprise, he heard that same small, clear voice that he knew so well. Now, Paul didn't know what to say, but suddenly he blurted out, "Can you tell me how to spell the word fix?" There was a long pause, then came the soft answer, "I guess your finger must be healed by now." Well, Paul laughed. "So it really is you," he said. "Do you have any idea how much you meant to me during those times when I was a little boy?" "I wonder," the lady said, "if you know how much your calls meant to me. You see, I never had any children, and I used to look forward to your calls very much." Well, Paul told her how much he had missed her over the years and asked if he could call her again when he was back in the area. "Please do," she said. "Just ask for Sally." 3 months later, Paul was back in Seattle. This time, a different voice answered, and so he did what she asked, and he asked for Sally. "Are you a friend?" the operator asked. "Yes, I'm a very dear friend," Paul answered. "Well, I'm sorry to have to tell you this," she said, "but Sally had been working part-time the last few years because she was sick, and Sally died 5 weeks ago." Before he could hang up, the operator said, "Wait a minute, did you say that your name was Paul?" "Yes," he replied. And she said, "Well, Sally left a message for you. She wrote it down in case you called in. Let me read what the message says. It says, when Paul calls, tell him that I still say there are other worlds to sing in. He will know what I mean." Paul thanked her and hung up, and he did know what Sally meant. There are other worlds to sing in. Isn't that a beautiful and powerful thought? And that is what John 3 is about. There are other worlds to sing in this life, yes, and because God so loved the world even beyond this life. Jesus said to Nicodemus that night, "You must be born anew. You must be born from above." He was telling us that he loves us so much that we do not have to stay here. And we do not have to stay as we are. We, the whosoevers, can make a new start. We, the whosoevers, can have a new life. We, the whosoevers, can be a new person. He loves us so much that there are other worlds to sing in, for life is eternal. To whosoever. This is, as Martin Luther said, the gospel in miniature. This brief passage of scripture tells us what is absolutely vital to life. Whosoever is loved eternally by our God. Let us pray. Dear God, all of us here are part of the whosoevers that Jesus speaks about.